Hi, I am Tahir Ramzan from Ashraf Iqbal Workshops of Pedagogy, Pakistan. The title of my today's presentation is The 2D and 3D Motion, Learning 2D, Best Mix of Pedagogy and Technology. Motion is the most ill-understood concept. Uniform circular motion is present in galactic as well as atomic level. Projectile motion is studied extensively in schools, colleges, and the first course of calculus in the universities. There are many examples of 2D and 3D diagrams available on the textbook as well as on World Wide Web. At Ashraf Iqbal Workshops of Pedagogy, we found there is a problem with the concept of motion, like time is not present in the 2D and 3D motion diagrams, which is complicating and confusing the concept. And the equation, and in the equation in the form of x square plus y square is equal to r square, there is no time. And it is a pedagogical hurdle to understand the concepts of motion and utilize that. With the help of technology, particularly GeoGebra, we can incorporate the concept of time in our diagrams in color using colorful simulations like this. This is a very simple and straight simulation. You can see there are four points A, B, C, and D. These all points will move into a circle, but with different velocities. So this simple example will illustrate not only the concept of functions like exponential functions, linear functions, logarithmic functions, but the concept of displacement, velocity, and acceleration, which are really important to understand with regard to time. Let me play this. You can see A is moving really fast. B, C, and D are very slow. And we can observe A is slowing down somehow. And C and D are increasing their speeds. This can be a game as well. Like we can easily insert a picture of cars in place of A, B, C, and D point to make it quite playful and interactive for school students. This can be a game of cars. Students can bet on these cars and challenge each other that the student who will win will have a better concepts of functions. That how linear functions, how exponential functions, how composite functions, how logarithmic functions work. So these type of concept and simulations make these type of difficult concepts to make them really easy. So we are working on these type of simulations which help students to understand different concepts of 2D and 3D motions, projectile motions, and uniform circle motions, and make connection between them. There is another screenshot from another simulation where there is we presented projectile motion, where the horizontal velocity is different in all three objects, and the height is same, the time length is same. You can see the throwing height is same, and the elapsed time is same, and the falling time is same, but the projectile is different for each of these objects. So these type of simulations really help students to understand the underlying concepts behind the displacement, velocity, acceleration, gravity, etc. in a meaningful and playful environment. Here is another example of one simulation where there is an object moving in the circle. In this screenshot, you can see the x and y component of displacement as well as direction of displacement. Now you can see the direction of velocity as well as x and y component of velocity. Now you can see the direction amplitude of acceleration as well as x and y components of acceleration. And in this example, you can see all of three. So this can help students to understand the underlying concept of these confusing and complex topics, which is not possible without the help of the interactive softwares like GeoGebra. Like earlier, there was 2D diagrams on the textbooks. We are making these type of stories to help students make these concepts playful and easy. When we make connections and connect projectile motion to uniform circle motion, and then the motion of heavenly bodies and satellites, and then ask questions like when will the object or satellite or planet start orbiting the sun or orbiting the earth, etc. What will be their orbit, circular, elliptical, parabola, hyperbola, all forms of conic sections. These all make connections and student start understanding these confusing concept in a really enjoyable environment. So this is what we are doing. Thank you. Questions?
Hello, I am Aditi from Center for Creative Learning, IIT Gandhinagar, and we will be discussing this paper on computational thinking based on geometry of vegetables. So about a year ago, with the help of CBSE and Vigyan Prasar, we at Center for Creative Learning, IIT Gandhinagar, conducted an online program called the 30-30 STEM. So this program aimed at discovering the beauty of mathematics and science and nurturing the inherent curiosity by engaging in hands-on activities. So generally in classes, we try to start from a subject and then move to an object. In 30-30 STEM, we tried the other way around, started with an object and then moved to a subject. For example, we took objects like an A4 sheet, like a candle, bicycle, cricket, vegetables, and many more, and then started relating it to different subjects. One such episode focused on the mathematics and the computational thinking behind vegetables, and we designed many hands-on activities to make learning mathematics and science more interesting. We started with some interesting questions and we could interact with the audience using item pool, so we could get real-time answers and feedbacks from the audience. So to start with, let me ask you a very interesting question. How would you best describe a Locky, or what we call as a bottle gourd? Would you call it a circle, a rectangle, an ellipse, or a sine wave? And to understand this, let's take a look at the Locky we have. So this is a piece of bottle gourd, and what we are going to do is take out a piece from it. Now this piece we will try to cut such that the diameter of this Locky is same as the height is, and what we do is we cut out a piece. So now when we look at this piece and see it from the top, what we see is a circle. If we keep it flat like this, what we see is a rectangle or a square. Since we had taken the diameter and the length or the height here equal, the shape which we get is a square. Now, what I do is I take my knife and make a slant cut. So I'll start from this corner here and move diagonally to the opposite corner here. So let me do this. So we have two pieces. So when I take one of these pieces and see it from the top, I still see a circle. But when I see it in a plane perpendicular to the surface, what I see is an ellipse. Now, how do you prove it is an ellipse? One more very interesting question is that if this is an ellipse, how would you locate the two focus of these ellipses? And to understand this, we have a wonderful GeoGebra model which is very non-intuitive. It is based on something called as the Dandelion's sphere, and what we have here is a cylinder just like a gourd, and we have made a slant cut on it. So what we get is an ellipse in the middle here. Now, to find the focus of this ellipse, we drop two spheres, one from the top and one from the bottom. These two spheres are tangent or touch our ellipse at exactly two points, and very non-intuitively, these two points are the focus of this ellipse. And why stop at the ellipse? Since we still have the knife, what we can do is take off the peel of this section. What we get is a sine wave. You can actually cut it and see. Now, assuming that the radius and the height of this cylinder piece was one unit and both were equal, we get the area of this whole cylinder to be 2 pi units. Now, since we divided it into two equal parts, the area of each of these parts would be equal to pi units. So the area of the sine curve is exactly pi units, which is same as the base of the cylinder. So if the radius here is 1, the area of this circle would also be pi. Now what I do is, at an exactly half distance, I make a horizontal cut like this. So we have two pieces here, and if we take this top piece, the area of this piece is exactly one unit, which is same if we have a piece of square whose sides are one unit each. This can also be visualized using this GeoGebra model. So the fact that a piece of a cylinder is independent of pi gives a sense of wonder, and it helps us think critically using computational thinking. Next activity, we would need a Mosambi or a sweet lime, and what we are going to do is make a slice out of it. So we have a sweet lime, and what we have done is cut a slice from it. Now what we do is we cut another piece from the sweet lime such that both have the same height. So we have two pieces here who have the same height. Now what can you say about the area of these two pieces? And the result of this is Well, it's mind-blowing. So, long back, Archimedes proved that if you have a piece of a sphere, both of equal heights, irrespective of from where it was cut from, both these pieces will have the same area. Archimedes also proved that if you have a cylinder and a sphere, both of the same radius and the same height, then both the shapes or both the pieces will have the exactly same area. In our classes too, we could pose this as a problem, asking students prove how these areas would be equal. One more thing which we do in the classes is simply say that the volume of a pyramid is equal to 1/3 the volume of a cube. So what I have here is a cube which is being cut out from a potato, and the question which can be put forward to the students of the class could be, you need to cut three pyramids who have equal area from this cube. So for doing that, what they would have to do is pick out a vertex and there will be three sides along it. Then what you do is you start cutting from this vertex and move along the opposite edge. So you go diagonally to the opposite edge and you make this cut. So what I get here are three pyramids which are equal in volume and whose base is the square from the previous cube. In engineering, there is a subject called as engineering drawing where you would be given an object and you will have to view it from different directions and put it into papers. Something very similar happens even in class 7th or 8th, where students are asked to depict the front view, the top view, the back view on a paper of an object. But often what happens is these objects are not real. Students can't feel it, they can't see it, they can just see it in papers, which is not how it might be done. So in the episode, we had a very interesting question, which was to cut. In engineering, there is a subject called as engineering drawing, where you would be given an object and you will have to view it from different directions and put it into papers. Something very similar happens even in class 7th or 8th, where students are asked to depict the front view, the top view, the back view on a paper of an object. But often what happens is these objects are not real. Students can't feel it, they can't see it, they can just see it in papers, which is not how it might be done. So in the episode, we had a very interesting question, was to cut out a single piece of gourd in such a way that you can see a circle from one side, a triangle from the other, and a square from the third side. We got some amazing answers from the participants. So all these hands-on activities and homework problems, along with the stories, engages everyone and helps them think critically. The engagement graph of this episode also shows something very similar. So the average view time of this episode was about 10 minutes, which is exceptional for an educational video, where the average view time is less than 2 minutes. About 30,000 viewers joined us live, which was even more exceptional. Participants' feedback also shows how they think about a problem for weeks and just feel happy when they come up with an answer. This suggests that stories, real-life context, object-oriented activities, and thought-provoking questions can bring back the fun in learning. So when we start with a relatable object and then move on to subjects like math, science, history, and many more, what happens is this triggers the computational thinking and the thinking capacity of everyone. So our experience of working with teachers and students to develop these activities suggests that these types of activities and lessons can help us achieve the interdisciplinary approach and give students a space to think. Thank you.